good video clips and very entertaining, followed by assessment of psychosexual disorders by very learned speaker Dr. Ajit Awasthi. He gave us the practical tips to how to assess a case of psychosexual disorder, followed by male sexual disorders and female sexual disorders. And finally, another interesting unorthodox presentation by our dear Dr. Rajiv Gupta. He is always away from the mainstream and always having the unorthodox kind of lecture. So we have listened to Dr. Rajiv Gupta. Dr. Andrade, in his first presentation, gave some idea about the drugs and psychosexual disorders. In this particular lecture, it is very much focused on pharmacotherapy of sexual dysfunction. We all know this is very useful for all of us, particularly for PG students, because another skills we have to learn over the years. But from very beginning of our practice, we must know the pharmacotherapy of each and every illnesses. Schizophrenia and bipolar disorders are very common when we are able to use psychopharmacology to treat these disorders. But something like psychosexual disorders, it is very confusing, and sometimes we don't have the clear-cut idea what drug we should use in what particular type of illness, what particular type of psychosexual disorders. We are lucky that we have an authority like Dr. Chittaranjan Andrade, who is the authority on psychopharmacology. We have listened, sir, for so many times, and every time we learn certain new things. So without wasting much time, I invited Dr. Andrade to please deliver his lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everybody. In this presentation on pharmacotherapy of sexual dysfunction, again, it's going to be more a classroom lecture. The intention is to help you to answer if you are asked this question in an examination, either written examination or oral examination. I'm not citing references again, just as I didn't cite references in my previous presentation. I'm not going to be talking to you about the findings of different studies, right? This is going to be a practical and classroom focused teaching sort of presentation. When talking about the pharmacotherapy of sexual dysfunction, please remember that pharmacotherapy can never be done in isolation. It needs to be considered along with psychosocial interventions. It needs to be considered along with intervention that addresses the problem, the causes of the problem. And therefore, in this presentation, in addition to pharmacotherapy, I'm going to be speaking a very little bit on other issues that need to be attended to along with pharmacotherapy. So, I will be speaking about treatment of the causes of sexual dysfunction, psychological as well as medical, treatment of the disorders themselves, where I'm focusing specifically on three disorders. I'm not going to be covering everything. I'm focusing on erectile dysfunction, premature ejaculation, and female sexual interest arousal disorder. What psychosexual disorders are depends upon the fashion of the day. As you all know, for example, being homosexual at one time was included in ICD and DSM as a psychosexual disorder. And for example, I must tell you a little joke in this regard. Today we no longer consider being homosexual as being a disorder. We consider it to be a different form of normality. In Sweden, when protests began to were launched against the medicalization of being homosexual, One very clever thing that a lot of people did was they phoned into their office to say, I'm feeling gay today, I want sick leave. Okay? So today we have fewer sexual disorders than we had in earlier years. I'm focusing on erectile dysfunction, premature ejaculation, and female sexual interest, arousal disorders, because these are the three disorders for which there's a good deal of pharmacotherapy that is available. I'm going to be covering also miscellaneous treatments that are used in sexual disorders. Now, you can't treat using drugs unless you also treat other issues. Decreased desire occurs as people grow older, and you can't do anything about this. So part of your treatment towards somebody who's 90 years old and still wants to have sex would be to help that person understand that it is difficult at his or her age. Part of the problem could arise from childhood sexual abuse, which could cause an individual to have a feeling of revulsion towards sex. So maybe psychosocial interventions are necessary over here to help the individual with these problems. A big chunk of explanation for sexual dysfunction today: stress, loss of sleep, and physical fatigue. So often today you will come across couples, young couples in their 20s and 30s, who have sex once in 2 weeks or once a month because they don't feel the urge for having sex more frequently. And they don't realize that they are dysfunctional because they are so preoccupied with work and other activities that they don't even have time to know what they are missing out on. So high stress in their daily life, for example, working long hours in the office, having targets, deadlines, and so on, not sleeping for whatever reason, associated with coming home late, having dinner late, watching an episode or two on TV and then coming to bed, not much time available for sex, not much time to think of sex in situations like that. Physical fatigue due to any reason. These are the three commonest causes. And if these people come to you and expect you to prescribe a magic medicine to help you to help them overcome their sexual problems, you're not going to be very effective in these situations unless you address these issues. They must learn that they need to control the levels of stress in their life, sleep better, and reduce the levels of physical fatigue if your treatments are going to work. Your treatments may not even be necessary if these are addressed. Decreased desire can also occur due to, so these are psychosocial reasons. Decreased desire could also occur due to medical reasons. You take an extreme situation where a person has asthma and is wheezing. Now, how would this person be able to engage in sexual activity? If a person has chronic pain due to any medical cause, how would this person have sexual desire or have the ability to have an erection or enjoyment of sexual activity? So just as these extreme examples, pain, wheezing, and so on, can compromise an individual's sexual functions, minor medical problems, which you do not know about because you haven't asked about the medical issues that the patient has, they may explain the patient's sexual dysfunction, and the patient wouldn't tell you or volunteer the information because the patient doesn't make a connection. So you need to ask a patient about comorbidities. Then there could be problems related to elevated prolactin. Prolactin can be elevated not just because of antipsychotic drugs, risperidone, prolactin, typical antipsychotics. Even SSRIs in some patients can raise serum prolactin levels. Keep this in mind. SSRIs can raise serum prolactin levels. Serum prolactin can be elevated during lactation and so on. And this can affect sexual desire, sexual drive. Then any drug that affects the levels of sexual hormones. The most common example is the use of finasteride and dutasteride, which are anti-testosterone drugs, which are used to treat male pattern baldness and used to treat benign prostatic hypertrophy in men. So, addressing the causes also for decreased arousal. So, in the previous slide, I looked at decreased desire. In this slide, I'm looking at decreased arousal. Age, there is nothing you can do about reducing a person's age so that the person is able to experience erection or vaginal lubrication better. Performance anxiety can lead to decreased arousal. If a person is anxious about performing the sexual act, the person's anxiety drives sympathetic activity, and with higher sympathetic activity, they're able to achieve an erection is compromised. The person has erectile dysfunction. The same three gentlemen whom we met in the previous slide, stress, physical fatigue and loss of sleep, can impair an individual's ability to have erection. You need to address all these if your drugs are going to work. Most important would be, but also substantially important is problems with partner relationship and attractiveness. In this context, when I was doing my residency and I was working in a family psychiatry unit in Nimhangs, there was a couple, middle-aged couple, who had marital dysfunction. One of the big issues between them was that the husband wanted his wife to have short hair, and she said, if I have short hair, I look like a prostitute. And it was a big issue of difference in opinion between the two of them. It only later emerged that he had erectile difficulties and he wanted her to have short hair so that he could find her more attractive and find it more easy to have an erection when having intercourse with her. So problems with attractiveness can be an issue for sexual dysfunction. Problem with partner relationships. Today it is so easy to fight with each other. Why? For example, roles. Husband working, wife working. If both of them are working, who does the housework? So they fight about that. Then today, women are more aware of their rights and about equality issues, whereas men have not yet come to terms with this. So they fight about this. If they're always fighting with each other, how can they find each other sexually attractive for sexual intercourse? So these psychosocial issues need to be addressed if your medications are going to be effective. Now, these are psychosocial issues. Medical issues will also need to be addressed. For example, atherosclerosis is a common cause of sexual dysfunction in males. As men become older, because of atherosclerosis, there's narrowing of the arterioles supplying the penis. So the capacity for blood flow into the penis decreases and the ability to achieve erection is compromised. So this may need to be addressed through the use of statins. Even preventively, neuropsychiatric endocrine disorders can compromise sexual functioning. I hardly need to explain this. Anticholinergic treatments, adrenergic treatments. From my previous presentation, you would know how anticholinergic treatments can compromise erection, how adrenergic treatments can compromise erection. Alcohol use. Shakespeare had something very nice to say about it. He said, paraphrasing, alcohol increases the desire but taketh away from the performance. So persons using alcohol are more interested in members of the opposite sex in women, but are less able to actually perform a sexual act. So in chronic alcoholics, sexual performance is compromised. Remember also in patients with chronic alcoholics, there's hepatitis, the ability to metabolize hormones is compromised. Estrogen levels go up in males, testosterone levels are compromised. These individuals experience some degree of feminization also, decreased sexual desire, decreased sexual performance. Many lifestyle behaviors may contribute to the medical causes like smoking and alcohol use. Smoking has effects also on the arteries. Alcohol use, I already spoke about. Sedentary lifestyle, intake of saturated fats, trans fat, high sugar diet, these increase the risk of diabetes, atherosclerosis, and so on. Being overweight or obese, here is something important that you can tell persons. See, for a woman, attractiveness comes. A woman wants to be attractive, right? A man doesn't care how attractive he is. He only thinks of how long the penis is. So if you tell a person you lose weight and so your abdominal fat decreases and so this will actually lead to an increase in the apparent length of the penis. That's a strong motivating factor for a man to start exercising and reducing food intake, right? So these are things that you can do to improve sexual performance when you prescribe. This is also something that you can do to motivate people to eat healthy food. Then addressing the causes for delayed or no orgasm, naivete. Women, surprisingly, even in this age, particularly in developing societies, in India, and I'm talking about experience with people, with patients who speak to me, they don't even know where to stimulate themselves or how to stimulate themselves to obtain an orgasm. So when they do not have this knowledge, naturally for them desire, for them ability to attain orgasm will be compromised. Neuropsychiatric, neuroendocrine disorders can result in delayed or no orgasm. SSRIs, 5-HT reuptake inhibitors and alpha-1 blockers, again, I spoke about this in my previous presentation, can compromise the ability to attain orgasm. I will skip this slide because of issues related to time. Few quick words about definition and then treatment. Erectile dysfunction is one of the three conditions that I said I will focus on. It's the inability to maintain an erection for a period that is sufficiently long for desired sexual activity. For erectile dysfunction to be given the status of a disorder, it should be at least 6 months in duration. And the specifier in DSM is generalized versus situational. Generalized means at all times, including, for example, while masturbating. Situational may be only during intercourse with a partner or maybe intercourse with a specific partner. Now, what is the prevalence? These numbers are very easy to remember. 50% at age 50, 60% at age 60, 70% at age 70. You need to know these numbers because when you talk to people, it's very reassuring that what they are experiencing is not rare at all. Even a 20-year-old male can have erectile dysfunction. It would most likely be situational rather than generalized. But please remember, on some occasions, it is almost any male, particularly a stressed male, a person who hasn't slept, who has physical fatigue, could have compromised erectile functioning, and this could make him anxious and have performance anxiety on the next occasion. A vicious cycle develops. So knowing these numbers can be very helpful to reassure people. Now, erectile dysfunction treatments have been described for millennia, not even 10 and 20 years or hundreds of years, for millennia. In China, historical records show that 4,500 years ago, there was a potion which was prescribed with 22 ingredients for reducing sexual dysfunction in elderly men. In Egypt, in the time of the pharaohs, 1600 BC, baby crocodile heart and wood oil was prescribed for local application. How do you apply a crocodile heart on the genitalia? Well, I don't know, but this is what was applied. Landmarks in the treatment of erectile dysfunction started in 1973 with implantable and inflatable penile prosthesis. This might sound funny, put a tube into the penis and before sexual activity, like a bicycle, you pump it up and so on. But actually it worked and it allowed men to have satisfactory intercourse. Today, of course, the use of prosthesis is still being done, but is not as common as before. In 1998, sildenafil took the world by storm. The introduction of Viagra, or the blue pill, as it was then called, broke all records for drug sales until then. And for understandable reasons as well, because until then, see, Viagra came onto the scene the way ECT, clopromazine, imipramine, and so on came onto the scene. What was there before Viagra? So treatments for erectile dysfunction start with testosterone, but only if testosterone levels are low. And this you will know only if you do a blood test and find that the testosterone levels are low. It doesn't make sense doing testosterone levels unless you believe that the individual has. Why? Because the person, for example, is old, the person has maybe has symptoms of fatigue, symptoms of dysentery, symptoms of depression, and so on. You can do testosterone levels. If it's low, testosterone supplementation can be done. PDE5 inhibitors, sildenafil, tadalafil, vardenafil, and so on. Prostaglandins like aripostatil, apomorphine can be given. Vacuum constriction devices to suck blood into the penis. Penile prostheses, as I've already spoken about. Just to remind you about what I told you in the previous session about sildenafil, vardenafil, and so on actions, the amino acid L-arginine is converted by nitric oxide synthase to nitric oxide. Nitric oxide as a cofactor acts on iron in the enzyme, activating the enzyme that converts GMP to cyclic GMP, and cyclic GMP is the key player which produces vasodilatation by relaxing the smooth muscles in the arterioles that supply blood to the penis. This results in erection in the male. Now, the action of cyclic GMP is brief, very brief, lasts only for a few minutes, and it is terminated by phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor, which is the PDE5 version of the enzyme that is present in the genitalia. And PDE5 inhibitors, therefore, prolong the action of cyclic GMP, prolonging the duration of erection that an individual has upon stimulation of the penis. Now, the common PDE5 inhibitors that are used are sildenafil, tadalafil, vardenafil, and avenafil, of which the first two are commonly used in India, and these first two are the ones that you need to be aware of. Now, they work only in tandem with sexual stimulation. For example, if a male takes sildenafil, he's not going to have an erection unless he touches his penis or unless the partner touches the penis, stimulates the penis, and facilitates the erection. So, sildenafil, in combination with sexual stimulation, leads to an erection which stays. Why does the erection stay? Because the cyclic GMP is still present in the tissues. It hasn't been metabolized as yet. So there is still vasodilatation of the arterioles supplying blood to the penis, and so the erection is maintained. Sildenafil, tadalafil, and so on are effective for all causes of erectile dysfunction, whether the erectile dysfunction is psychogenic, whether it is associated with age, whether it is associated with neurological factors like, for example, spinal disease, or, for example, diabetic neuropathy. So it's effective for all causes of erectile dysfunction as long as blood can flow into the penis These can produce dilatation of the penis. For that, the artery supplying the penis should not be hardened and narrow. They should be capable of dilatation. So that is the reason why the magnitude of benefit with these drugs varies across individuals. For individuals in whom there is capacity for arteriolar vasodilatation in the penis, the benefits are best. For individuals in whom the capacity for arteriolar vasodilatation is impaired by, for example, severe atherosclerosis, the benefits are poorer. Note that these don't work for everybody and all the time, but they usually work for most persons most of the time. The efficacy will improve when combined with other treatments such as testosterone, particularly in people with low testosterone levels. Now, the common drugs that are used, as I told you, are sildenafil, tadalafil, vardenafil, and avagafil. How would you choose between these drugs? Most people prefer tadalafil, and here is the reason. Tadalafil has a half-life of 18 hours. Now, why is this such a big deal? Imagine that an individual is taking sildenafil instead. Sildenafil would need to be taken a few hours before planned sexual activity. How does the individual know that he's going to be sexually active at a particular time? Very often he does know, but there are times when a person is not sure, right? If the person is not sure whether or not he is going to be sexually active within the next few hours, then he would have to take the medication each time he thinks that he might have the opportunity to have sex a few hours later. This could be problematic for people who don't have an assured partner or people who do not have an assured cooperative partner, right? So, in such circumstances, tadalafil becomes more useful because the individual can take the drug, take tadalafil, and if there's no activity within the next few hours, doesn't matter. He can wait till the next day and have sex. The same dose of medication would benefit him the next day as well. You see? So with tadalafil, the window of opportunity for the person to have sexual intercourse is wide. With sildenafil, the window of opportunity is narrow. Why? Because tadalafil has a longer half-life. With the other PDE5 inhibitors, the half-life is in the region of 4 to 5 hours. So within 4 to 5 hours, maximum 8 hours to 12 hours, the efficacy is lost. With tadalafil, the efficacy is prolonged. Another advantage of tadalafil is people need food. Sexual activity usually occurs at night. People have dinner at night. Dinner contains maybe fatty substances. A high fat meal can impair the absorption of PDE5 inhibitors, but not the absorption of tadalafil. So a person can take tadalafil before food, after food. It does not make a difference. The absorption is not impaired. Whereas with the other PDE5 inhibitors, absorption is impaired. The onset of action is fastest with avagafil, but then it's unlikely that anybody is going to have the opportunity. Do I have a few more minutes? I'll rush through. That actually tells me my time is up, or that tells me I have 5 minutes more. 5 minutes more. Okay. So with avagafil, it's unlikely that a person will, for example, have an opportunity. We are going to have sex in 15 minutes now, so hurry up with your medication, right? So he will have some kind of idea that he's going to have sexual intercourse. So it's okay to take any of the other drugs. Again, tadalafil is a good idea. Vardenafil has the slowest onset of action. Adverse effects of PDE5 inhibitors, vardenafil can cause dose-dependent QTC prolongation. Sildenafil can cause flushing in a lot of individuals. It can cause blue vision, which actually is not really a problem, a little bit uncomfortable, particularly at night when sexual activity takes place. Rarely it can cause optic neuropathy. Tadalafil can cause myalgia in some persons. What is the dose? You need to know these two. Sildenafil, the dose is 25 to 50 mg per day in the majority of persons. In persons for whom 25, to, sorry, per occasion in the majority of persons, in persons for whom this does not work, 50 to 100 mg can be given. Tadalafil, the median dose, most people require 10 mg. Doses as low as 5 mg to as much as 20 mg can be used. Some of these are available as wafers. Sildenafil wafers are available, can be used sublingually, dissolved in the mouth under the tongue, absorbed through the buccal mucosa for a more rapid onset of action. I'll skip this. Alprostagil was administered as an injection into the urethra. What a painful way to plan to have sex. Apomorphine used to be available in India, but the companies apparently have taken it off. Apomorphine sublingual, given in the dose of 3 to 4 mg, produced erection in 15 to 20 minutes and often erection without a need for sexual stimulation. But unfortunately, apomorphine also produces nausea. It's an opioid, it can produce nausea. And imagine trying to have sex when you want to throw up on your partner's face. So premature ejaculation, the concept is short latency to ejaculation, usually less than 1 minute. Maybe I should. Has this been covered in previous presentations? It's been covered. So I'll skip this slide. I'll come to treatment where pharmacotherapy involved anesthetic creams. Why anesthetic creams? Because it decreases sensitivity of the penis. So the desire to ejaculate is delayed. But the problem is, why do people have intercourse? Because they enjoy the penile sensation. Now imagine putting anesthesia on the penis and trying to have intercourse after that. It decreases not only pressure for the male, but decreases pressure for the female as well, because there's some absorption of the cream by the vagina, of the anesthetic cream by the vagina. And it's like eating a sweet without taking the wrapper off. There's no point in it. SSRIs have been used. We discussed this in the previous session during a question and answer session. Depoxetine in the dose of 30 to 60 mg, 1 to 3 hours before sexual intercourse. Now, flibanserin. We had questions about flibanserin or the pink Viagra in the previous session. For hypoactive sexual disorder, it was developed as an antidepressant. It failed antidepressant trials. But just the way sildenafil was discovered by chance, I must tell you the story if somebody asks a question. Just as sildenafil was discovered serendipitously, flibanserin was discovered serendipitously because on the items of the rating scales for depression, women reported that, well, it was found to outperform placebo on the question, how strong is your sexual drive? This question was being assessed while the antidepressant potential of flibanserin was being studied. And it didn't work for any of the items regarding antidepressant activity. It worked only for the sexual functioning item. Flibanserin is dosed at 100 mg every night. How does flibanserin work? It is a 5-HT1A postsynaptic receptor agonist, which means it stimulates 5-HT1A receptors. Now, postsynaptic receptors, this receptor is an inhibitory receptor. So it inhibits serotonergic functioning. Just a few more minutes and then I'm done. It also blocks 5-HT2 receptors. So again, it inhibits serotonergic neurotransmission. And this action is preferential in the prefrontal cortex, as a result of which there is reduced serotonergic activity and serotonin levels in the prefrontal cortex and in the nucleus accumbens and in the hypothalamus. It also increases dopamine, norepinephrine in the prefrontal cortex, probably through its effect on 5-HT2A receptors, right? So it disinhibits the 5-HT2A receptors, which reduce dopamine or epinephrine levels. Because of these actions, sexual desire arousal is improved. Now, flibanserin efficacy was established in four six-month trials named after four different flowers conducted in women with premenopausal hypoactive sexual desire disorder. The improvements were small, but they were statistically significant because they were small and of questionable clinical significance. The improvements were found on some parameters, but not on all parameters, on rating scales for desire. That is why flibanserin was considered to be a controversial treatment. It is marketed under a risk management program because it can cause hypotension and syncope given alone, but especially when given with drugs that prolong its action, 3A4 inhibitors or alcohol or drugs or condition that reduce its metabolism such as liver disease. It is controversial, maybe you can ask me, because people ask, does the hypoactive sexual desire disorder really exist, or is it a normal variation like being gay, for example? If being gay is normal, why not having a lower sexual drive be considered normal? Why should we treat being gay with medications and treat decreased desire using medications? It may be a manufactured indication for making profits for a pharma company. If it exists and it's not a disorder, should it be treated? Or if you should it be treated with medicines, why not treat it by making a male partner increase the duration and quality of foreplay? But against this, which blames the male partner for decreased desire, should we blame the female partner for erectile dysfunction? We don't do this, right? So why blame the male partner for decreased desire? Actually, there is a good reason, and the reason is that males actually don't involve themselves in foreplay, and therefore women who take longer for arousal may have decreased arousal, decreased desire. The last issue about the controversy is whether the statistically significant benefits are clinically significant. Just approved in June 2019 is bremelanotide, brand name is Vyleesi. It's a neuropeptide, it's a melanocortin receptor agonist at MC3, MC4 receptors. It increases dopamine in the nucleus accumbens, thereby increasing the anticipation of pleasure associated with sexual activity. How is it discovered? It was known for more than half a century that drugs acting on melanocortin receptors increase sexual activity in animals. So the development of drugs acting at these receptors was initiated more than 30 or 40 years ago. With bremelanotide specifically, one of the scientists developing it injected it into himself because he was curious to see what happened. And he had an erection which lasted for 8 hours. So it can be given to men as well. Now, how is bremelanotide administered? Subcutaneously into intra-abdominal fat or into the fat in the thigh. It has been in studies given intranasally as well. You can't give it orally because it's a peptide, it will be digested. Peak levels in 30 to 60 minutes, half-life 2 to 4 hours, it improves desire in women and arousal in men. So, it is not dosed daily, right? It is dosed only when sexual activity is desired. So, it's given the way sildenafil, tadalafil and so on are dosed. Nausea can occur in 40% of women. So this nausea can be prevented with pre-treatment with ondansetron. Flushing is common in 20%. Increased blood pressure is common, but it's not an issue unless it is used every day. If it's used every day, the risk of hypertension is increased. Shouldn't be used in women with untreated or uncontrolled hypertension or cardiovascular disease. Rarely, hyperpigmentation can occur as a side effect. Other approvals are for remember I told you earlier that in women post-menopause there is vaginal thinning of the mucosa there is painful intercourse associated with thinning of the mucosa. So to treat vulvovaginal atrophy, estradiol vaginal inserts have been developed in women with moderate to severe dyspareunia associated with postmenopause. Last slide in my presentation, this is my last slide. There have been a number of other treatments that are available which are far too many to list, but which have not been FDA approved and which I don't think we should seriously consider. L-arginine, alone or in combination with other substances. Saffron, used in Iran to treat female sexual dysfunction associated with SSRIs, to treat erectile dysfunction in men. Don't trust any RCTs that come out from Iran. They are always positive. Various herbal formulations, particularly by Himalaya drug company and various other Ayurvedic pharmaceutical companies, again of questionable use. You'll see plenty of research in their home journal Probe, but the research is of dubious quality. So I think that's my that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for comprehensive lecture. Now session is open for questions. Questions should be brief, and new people should ask the questions. Kindly
brief and precise, and only one question per person.
Kindly introduce yourself.
I'm Dr. Farhana from SKIMS Medical College, Kashmir. My question is, at what age do men experience sexual dysfunction?
At what age? At any age. Once they reach sexual maturity, at any age sexual dysfunction can occur. But the prevalence, the kind of dysfunction and the prevalence changes with time. Like in younger persons, they are more likely to have premature ejaculation. In older persons, they are more likely to have erectile dysfunction. In women, dyspareunia is common at later ages. Right?
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. I am Dr. Karthik from AIIMS Jodhpur.
Doctor?
Karthik.
Maybe you should raise the mic a little. Yes.
Karthik. Thank you. Karthik from. My question is, are there any specific guidelines on when to initiate pharmacotherapy, and when we do initiate, for how long should we continue?
Okay, important question. When should you initiate? First, do a psychosocial evaluation. That is why I spend several slides on the psychosocial issues. First, do a psychosocial and medical evaluation to look to see what are the explanations for the problem, because there is no sense in treating using medicines unless you also treat the cause. And very often, it may suffice to simply reduce stress levels, make the partners sleep more, make them rest more, make them improve their interpersonal relationships. They may not need medical treatment at all, right? So initiate medical treatments once you have evaluated and addressed the psychosocial issues. This is in principle. In practice, when people come to you, they want treatment now. So in practice, what you will do is you will give them the treatment now. Like for example, if it's a young man, you might give him deposititing for premature ejaculation. If it's a middle-aged man, you might give him sildenafil or tadalafil for his erectile dysfunction. But you will also do the evaluation and start the treatment for all the psychosocial and medical causes leading to lifestyle issues.
Sir, like, it should be very brief so that another, okay. The organizer are reminding every time.
So you got my point.
Next one. Sir, I'm Dr. Shreshtha from RML Hospital. My question is, if a person comes to me who's never been sexually active and he comes to me with a problem of ED, should I actually start him on any drugs that we've just studied about?
See, if the person has never been sexually active and comes with ED, that means a person has difficulty in achieving an erection even while masturbating.
Yes.
Now, this means that there is something else. It's not, for example, performance anxiety, right? There must be something medical that is an issue over here. You need to evaluate this person.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Next one. Sir, I'm Dr. Manish Kumar.
Medical Gull. Evaluation of the person.
I'm Dr. Manish Kumar Gull from SMS, Jaipur. A person with chronic smoker and alcoholic.
Chronic smoker and alcoholic.
And alcoholic. He has stressors and mild to moderate depression.
with erectile dysfunction and premature ejaculation difficulty, then what is the treatment of choice?
So you would have to treat the depression, and you said erectile dysfunction with premature ejaculation, right?
Yes, sir.
You can give an SSRI which will take care of the premature ejaculation, but the SSRI can also decrease the desire. So you need to keep that in mind.
And also
you need to keep in mind that erectile dysfunction can be a cause of premature ejaculation. Has this been covered?
No, sir.
Okay. Not been covered. The reason is, if a person has erectile dysfunction, he wants to finish the act of intercourse as quickly as possible before he loses his erection. So he has premature ejaculation, less than 1 minute. Interpersonal dissatisfaction, patient and his wife. Right? So you have to look at this, the relationship between the ED and the premature ejaculation, and how depression may be responsible and what drugs may be doing over here.
But SSRI,
okay, you heard your chance. No more question, please sit down.
One last question.
Yes, please.
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Karan from AIIMS, Jodhpur.
Please introduce yourself first and be brief.
Sir, I'm Dr. Karan from AIIMS, Jodhpur. I just want to ask that you told about the role of aripiprazole in lowering the sexual dysfunction in psychotic illness. Sir, is there any role of lurasidone also in lowering the sexual dysfunction?
No.
Thank you, sir.
Lurasidone is a D2 receptor antagonist, right? Whereas it may not raise serum prolactin, lurasidone does not lower serum prolactin the way aripiprazole can do. Right? So aripiprazole is probably the drug of choice for patients with high serum prolactin.
Thank you, sir.
Brexpiprazole also.
This is the last one. Last
also.
One.
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Roof. I'm from GMC Srinagar, Kashmir. So having talked about the various psychosexual disorders and the diagnostic criteria thereof, for most of the disorders, if not all, time criteria is 6 months. What if a patient has all other like symptoms, right, fulfilling the criteria, but he's having the symptoms from last 5.5 months? Does that mandate treatment or not?
No, please don't worry about the duration. Don't worry about the diagnosis. Treat the patient, not the classification system. You're not treating ICD or DSM, you're treating a patient, right? So don't be rigid about 5.5 months, 6 months, or 1 month versus 6 months for that matter. The patient has come with a problem, you can address it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for the enlightening session. Now I request the chairpersons to felicitate the speaker with a token of our appreciation. May I now request Dr. S.K. Verma to felicitate the chairpersons with a token of our appreciation.